هيا على الفلاح.
In the year 9th Hijri, also known as Amul Wufud, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was given the reins of leadership were handed over to him, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you could say, was ruling over the whole of the Arabian Peninsula. And in the 10th Hijri, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was shown a dream. I saw in my dream that I had two gold bracelets. I disliked these bracelets and I blew in these bracelets. So I interpreted this dream to mean Al-Kazzabain, the two great liars, the liar of Yemen and the liar of Yamama. Now this man who was from Yamama, he was a very evil individual. The narrations mention that his name was Musaylimah bin Tuhama bin Kabir, and he was born and raised in Yamama, which in today's day and age is called Al-Jubayla. There were many tribes that apostated after the demise of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and in this group falls Musaylimah as well as the one who was from Yemen, Aswad Al-Ansi. They were those people who were after dunya. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu sent Ikrimah bin Abi Jahl towards Yamama to deal with the Banu Hanifa. Now the Banu Hanifa tribe, they were so great as warriors that they mentioned that the army that fought in the battle of Yamama, it was 40,000 men strong. Ikrimah bin Abi Jahl radiallahu anhu, he goes forward and he stays and he camps just outside Yamama, and looking at the situation, he decides that I should go and attack Banu Hanifa and Musaylimah Kadhab. Banu Hanifa and Musaylimah Kadhab, he repels the attack and causes severe great losses and great casualties against the army of Ikrimah bin Abi Jahl radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Now Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he sent direct instructions to Shurahbil bin Hasana radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He also fell into a misconception and he decided that I should attack the Banu Hanifa tribe, and he tried to overpower him, but the same situation happened to Shurahbil radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He was defeated and he was sent back by the Banu Hanifa tribe and Musaylimah Kadhab. The narrations mention that Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he wrote to Khalid bin Walid radiallahu anhu that his name was Musaylimah bin Tuhama bin Kabir. Now in his youth he traveled far and wide, and he tried to gain influence amongst his own people as well as other people, to such an extent that in his life the main aim and objective was, how can I influence and gain popularity amongst the people? He started learning magic, he started doing witchcraft, sorcery. The narrations mentioned that once he was known to have practiced a magic trick where he managed to fix a bird's wing back together, and from this people started believing in him. Now from this we can understand that this individual, even when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in Makkah al-Mukarramah, he was trying to gain influence and copy the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Nubuwa and try to be like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now when he came to Madinatul Munawwara with the Banu Hanifa tribe to accept Islam, he stayed outside tending the camels and taking care of other parcels of the Banu Hanifa tribe. Now when the Banu Hanifa tribe went to meet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked in regards to Musaylimah, and he gave gifts to the Banu Hanifa tribe, and alongside this he gave a gift to Musaylimah Kadhab. And when he gave this gift, he was told by the Banu Hanifa tribe about Musaylimah, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam coined his famous phrase in regards to him, and he said that verily this man Musaylimah, he is not the most evil one from amongst you. Now Musaylimah, hearing this from his companions, he went back to the Banu Hanifa tribe. He took advantage of this and he started telling people that, see, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said, I am not the evil, most evil from amongst you, meaning I am also a prophet, and that I am also sharing the nubuwa of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But in reality, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam meant that he is not the most evil amongst you, meaning you're all evil, but there are many other evil people similar to Musaylimah Kadhab. The narrations, they mention that he wrote a letter to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, O Messenger of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent you as a messenger just as he has sent me as a messenger. So therefore, you split up the land which belongs to the Quraysh between me and you. Why? Because these people are very unjust. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he wrote back to Musaylimah al-Kazzab saying, verily the land, it belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who is going to give it to his pious slaves. It doesn't belong to you. So Musaylimah, he was desperately trying to gain power from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he was trying to gain a lot of respect by doing certain things during his period of trying to be a prophet. Ibn Kathir rahmatullah alayhi says, Musaylimah heard that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam spat inside a well. The water became abundant. Musaylimah, he conducted his own experiment. So once he spat inside a well, the well, you can obviously understand, the well went totally dry. There was no water left inside that well. Another occasion, they mentioned that he spat in another well and the water, it became salty and bitter. Allama Ibn Kathir rahmatullah alayhi mentions another occasion that he took a group of children and he passed his hand over the heads of these children as barakah. And some of them, they developed a lisp, and some of them, they even became bold. So Musaylimah Kadhab was going around trying to convince certain individuals that he was the final prophet. Amr bin As radiallahu ta'ala anhu mentions that upon occasion, he went to see Musaylimah Kadhab when he was a non-Muslim, and they apparently had to meet each other. For whatever reason, Musaylimah asked Amr bin As that what has Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in regards to the Quran, what has been revealed? So Amr bin As radiallahu ta'ala anhu mentioned that wal asri innal insana lafi khusr. The whole surah was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now after hearing this, Musaylimah, he became really happy and anxious, and he said that I also have been given a blessed surah. And when he recited a surah, the narrations mentioned he talked about animals, frogs and rabbits. Amr bin As radiallahu ta'ala anhu turned to Musaylimah Kadhab and he said, Ya Musaylimah, by Allah, you know that I know that you are a great liar. Knowing how flimsy and how pathetic this individual was, he even went against Musaylimah Kadhab, even though he was not even a Muslim himself. There were many tribes that apostated after the demise of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There were mainly three groups. The first group were of those individuals who had left Islam because they had weak faith and they did not have full conviction inside the Quran as well as the teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The second group of individuals who were loyal to pre-Islamic beliefs and practices, they in reality weren't ready to accept Islam. As soon as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away, these individuals, they left the fold of Islam and they went back to their old customs and their tribalism and whatever they used to do in the days of Jahiliyyah. As for the third group, and in this group falls Musaylimah as well as the one who was from Yemen, Aswad al-Anasi. So they took the opportunity that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has passed away, so we should try to claim to be prophets. As for Aswad al-Anasi, he was killed during the lifetime of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So these were the different types of apostates. Now you have to understand, this time period, this was the harshest time or the most greatest trial for the companions after the demise of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because these groups slowly started to move away from Islam. This was causing a greater chance of Madinatul Munawwara being attacked by these very same groups. Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu was approached by Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu upon occasion, and Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu said, how many groups are you going to fight against, O Abu Bakr? These people are so many. It's better that we liaise with these individuals and later on we will try to reconcile or try to talk to these people. Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he took hold of the beard of Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu and he said, O Umar, have you become so weak and so fragile that you were great in the days of Jahiliyyah and now you have become weak when you have become a Muslim? I will never ever go with what you are saying. I will fight them till even if the dogs and the wolves of Medina, they eat my body parts up, I will still fight against these people, even if they're still not ready to give the rein of a camel that they used to give in the time of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he organized 11 groups to go and combat these apostates who had left Islam. One group he sent with was with Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala anhu. The second group he sent with was Ikrimah bin Abi Jahl radiallahu ta'ala anhu. The third group was Shurahbil bin Hasana radiallahu anhu. Another one was with Amr bin As radiallahu anhu. Now when these different groups were sent to different parts of the areas, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu sent Ikrima bin Abi Jahl radiallahu ta'ala anhu towards Yamama to deal with the Banu Hanifa. Now the Banu Hanifa tribe, they were so great as warriors that they mentioned that the army that fought in the Battle of Yamama, it was 40,000 men strong. 40,000 men strong, you can imagine how great of a battle this was and what great force the companions were going against at that time. But very rarely will people realize the true value of the companions who sacrificed their life in the Battle of Yamama. Ikrima bin Abi Jahl radiallahu anhu, he goes forward and he stays and he camps just outside Yamama, and looking at the situation, he decides that I should go and attack Banu Hanifa and Musaylimah Kadhab. Now when he takes this assault against the Banu Hanifa tribe, he attacks them. What happens? Banu Hanifa and Musaylimah Kadhab, he repels the attack and causes severe great losses and great casualties against the army of Ikrima bin Abi Jahl radiallahu ta'ala anhu. They mention that Ikrima radiallahu anhu, he wrote a letter back to Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu explaining the battle in detail and what had transpired, and Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu became really upset that he had only sent him to keep Musaylimah tied down in Yamama so that he does not move. Why was this? Because Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, being a general and being a wise commander, he knew that if Banu Hanifa tribe move from their position, the very first place that they will attack will be none other than the beloved city of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Madinatul Munawwara. Ikrima, he misjudged the option and he went to attack these people, but he caused a lot of loss to the Muslims and many Sahaba were injured in that battle. Ikrima radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he was ordered by Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu to go and help a certain other group of companions in another area, and he sent Shurahbil bin Hasana radiallahu ta'ala anhu to go and keep Banu Hanifa tribe in their own place so that they do not move. Now Shurahbil bin Hasana radiallahu ta'ala anhu, a great companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he arrived in the area of Yamama, he also fell into a misconception and he decided that I should attack the Banu Hanifa tribe, because he received news that Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala anhu will be coming and arriving at this very same place. He will assist me. So because of his jazba and his zeal for jihad, he went out and he tried to attack the Banu Hanifa tribe and Musaylimah Kadhab. But the same situation happened to Shurahbil radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He was defeated and he was sent back by the Banu Hanifa tribe and Musaylimah Kadhab. Now obviously, looking at the circumstances, Musaylimah and Banu Hanifa, they became even more haughty, they became even more proud. Now Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he sent direct instructions to Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who at that time had 6,000 men with him. He went directly to go and attack the Banu Hanifa tribe, and he teamed up with the other Sahaba and the other companions to go and fight against Musaylimah Kadhab. The narrations mention that Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he wrote to Khalid bin Walid saying that go towards Yamama with the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is what I have written towards you, that when you go and attack and you arrive at Yamama, then make sure you look and observe the circumstances why you have not met a group of people who are similar to the Banu Hanifa tribe. Why? Because these people were monsters. These people were evil. These people were such that they were ready to die for Musaylimah and for his cause. Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when he arrives and reaches his place, he observes the surrounding and he decides to split up his army and his forces into five parts. There was a right flank, then there was the left flank, there was the middle section, there was the front, and there was the behind section. Khalid bin Walid radiallahu anhu, he organized his troops in the same manner that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he organized his troops, which was known as Al-Khamis. Now Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when he arrived at Yamama, he decided to build a military post overlooking the battle of Yamama so that he could observe everything that is going on at that time. They marched towards one another. Now Musaylimah Kadhab, seeing the army of Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala anhu, where there were many great luminaries and many great companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, trying to make his people fight for this sacred cause of his, he said to his people, he said, Ya Bani Hanifa, O the children of Hanifa, today is the day of fury. If you are defeated, your women will become and taken for pleasure. They will be treated like maids. Therefore, fight for your pride and protect your women. Musaylimah Kazzab, he was making his people ready to fight against Khalid bin Walid. He was heating them up so that they were ready to die for the sake of Musaylimah Kazzab. Now, Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he clashed against the army of Musaylimah Kazzab. And Khalid bin Walid radiallahu anhu, the Sahaba, they mentioned, when the battle of Yamama was mentioned to Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, tears would flow through his eyes. Why? Because of the sacrifice of Khalid bin Walid radiallahu anhu. The companions mentioned that whenever we would see Khalid bin Walid in the battle of Yamama, he would be at the forefront fighting, trying to gain Shahada or gaining the victory for the companions and for the Muslims. You have to understand, when the Muslims look at the Battle of Badr, everyone talks about the Battle of Badr, how great the Battle of Badr was. But when you look at the Battle of Yamama, if the Battle of Badr had angels descending, then in the Battle of Yamama, you had companions who had the Quran inside their hearts, ready to sacrifice their lives for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the Battle of Badr, if you had 313 men fighting for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then in the Battle of Yamama, you had 700 huffaz who sacrificed their lives so that they could preserve the finality of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And despite this, they were ready to lay their lives down for the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he attacks, and the Muslims in the beginning of the battle, they fall short and they start being caused a lot of injuries by Musaylimah and his army because of the arrows that were being fired upon the Muslims at that time, to such an extent that the narrations mention that the Muslims, they had to push back, and Musaylimah and his army, they reached all the way up to the military post of Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala anhu. The narrations mention Ammar bin Yasir radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he came out in front of the Sahaba. The weak Muslims, they started running away from the battle. Ammar bin Yasir radiallahu anhu said, Ya ma'ashar al-Muslimin, are you running away from Jannah? Are you running away from paradise which has been promised to you? Here I am, Ammar ibn Yasir. Come to me. Now when this was happening, many, many great companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away. The likes of Zayd bin Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu. The narrations mention that he was holding the standard for the Muslims on the Battle of Yamama. And when all this commotion and these running back and forward of the Muslims was taking place, he said to Allah, he said, Allahumma, O Allah, I apologize for the running away of my companions, the falsehood and all the evil that Musaylimah has brought, O Allah, I free myself from all this. And they mention that he fought so bravely. Why shouldn't he fight so bravely when he was the brother of Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu? When the death of his brother was given to Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, they mention that Umar radiallahu anhu, he was in deep shock. And when he heard the martyrdom of his brother, he would say, May Allah have mercy upon my brother. May Allah have mercy upon my brother. He beat me towards two goods. He accepted Islam before me, and he was given martyrdom before me as well. Now when all this commotion was taking place, many great companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they all became shaheed during this period. Khalid bin Walid radiallahu anhu, looking at their circumstance, he realized that I will have to push towards Musaylimah. And the Ansar and many, many great Sahaba, they managed to attack and push back the Banu Hanifa tribe, and they pushed them all the way back to the Garden of Death, where Musaylimah and the tribe, Banu Hanifa tribe, they enclosed themselves inside a garden. They mentioned that the brother of Anas bin Malik radiallahu anhu, Barra bin Malik radiallahu anhu, he approached Khalid bin Walid radiallahu anhu, and he said, Oh Khalid, I have an idea. These individuals have locked themselves inside this enclosed garden, and it's impossible for us to climb over. I have an idea that you put me on a shield and Sahaba pick me up and they throw me over the garden. I will go on the other side. I will open the door and I will let the Muslims come inside. Many Sahaba, they disagreed with this option and with this opinion. Why? Because this was suicide. Khalid bin Walid radiallahu anhu also said that, Oh Barra, this is destruction. You're going to destroy yourself. Barra bin Malik radiallahu anhu said, I have hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that I will fulfill this task. So the Sahaba, they picked up Barra bin Malik radiallahu anhu, they managed to throw him over the garden, and he fought against the people who were inside that garden, and they managed to open the front door or the front gates to let the companions come inside that gate. Now when the Sahaba came inside this gate, they started killing. They mentioned that Musaylimah, he was watching the companions come inside, and this was the last point for Musaylimah, and this was going to be his time of death. Now amongst these companions, there was a companion who many people do not know the true value of. One companion was Wahshi radiallahu anhu. Now this man, he was the killer of Hazrat Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu. The narrations mention that the day that he killed Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when he became a Muslim, everyone would say, "There goes the killer of Hamza, there goes the killer of Hamza," to such an extent that they used to label him without even his true proper name. They would say, "There is the killer of Hamza." He had so much remorse in his heart that the very same spear that he had, that he killed Hazrat Hamza radiallahu anhu with, he took an oath and he said, "Oh Allah, I repent to you, give me the ability that this very same spear that I killed the best of creation, give me the ability that I kill the worst of creation." So Wahshi radiallahu anhu, he comes inside the garden and he sees that Musaylimah is wailing like a camel and there's no one there around him, and he's very anxious, he's frustrated, he knows the time, his time has come, that he's going to die. Wahshi radiallahu anhu, he throws his spear from wherever he was and it penetrates through the stomach of Musaylimah Kadhab, and Wahshi radiallahu anhu says, "Allahu Akbar, I killed the best of people in the days when I was a jahil, and I've killed the worst of people now that I have become a Muslim." And thereafter, there was a time in his life where people would say, "There goes the killer of Hamza radiallahu anhu," and then there was a time in his life where people would say, "There goes the great companion who killed Musaylimah Kadhab." Musaylimah Kadhab was killed by Wahshi radiallahu ta'ala anhu. The narrations mention, and Abu Dujana radiallahu anhu, that these were the two individuals who killed Musaylimah Kadhab. The reason why they call it the Garden of Death was, according to a narration, they say that 10,000 soldiers of the Banu Hanifa tribe of Musaylimah Kadhab were killed only inside that garden. And some narrations mention 21,000 soldiers of Musaylimah Kadhab were killed inside that garden. And this was a great honor for the companions. And whenever the Sahaba would mention the Battle of Yamama, then some Muslims would become happy and some Muslims would become upset. Why? Because the happiness that they've killed the greatest fitna and the biggest evil person at that time, who was none other than Musaylimah Kadhab. And when they would remember the Battle of Yamama, then the narrations mention that in that Battle of Yamama, 700 Huffaz were martyred in that battle. Abu Aqil radiallahu anhu, he was a man from the Ansar. They mentioned that he was the first man to be injured on the day of Yamama. An arrow struck his arm somewhere between his shoulder and his heart, and because of this he went to seek medical attention and he could not participate. There was another companion, Ma'an bin Adi radiallahu anhu. He called out to the Ansar, he said, "Ya ma'ashar al-Ansar, O Ansar, remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, hold firmly and go and attack your enemy." Abu Aqil radiallahu anhu, imagine, the man has been hurt with an injury which was life-threatening. When this call was made by Ma'an bin Adi radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that he tried to get up from where he was lying down, and he was saying to his friends, "Let me go, let me go." And the people were saying to him, "How can you go?" And they mentioned he picked up a sword with his right hand and he fought so bravely that the narrations mention that he was inflicted with 14 wounds to such an extent that he fell on the floor and he was injured so badly that Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, he passed by him, and Abu Aqil radiallahu anhu, all he said to Ibn Umar was, "Who has won today?" Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu said, "Abshir," he said, "see glad tidings, be happy. Musaylimah qad qutil," he has been killed. And they mention Abu Aqil radiallahu anhu, he raised his hand towards the sky and they say that in that condition his soul departed and he met Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in that state. Another companion who was killed during this commotion was Abdullah bin Suhail radiallahu ta'ala anhu, a Badri companion. Another companion who passed away in this battle, his name was Ma'an bin Adi radiallahu anhu. Now this companion was so unique, the narrations mention that when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away and many companions, they were crying, they were lamenting, Ma'an bin Adi radiallahu anhu, he turned around to the companions and he said a very profound statement. He said, "I will prove to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, now that he has passed away, that I am a true Muslim, just as how I proved it to him when he was alive amongst us." Ma'an bin Adi radiallahu anhu, he also gave his life for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Battle of Yamama. two great companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abu Hudhayfa and Salim, the freed slave of Abu Hudhayfa radiyallahu ta'ala anhuma. They mention that Salim, he was so blessed and he was so great in the eyes of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned, he said, take the Quran from four people, min ummi ibn abd wa ubay ibn ka'b wa min Salim mawla Abi Hudhayfa wa Mu'adh ibn Jabal. If you want to learn the Quran exactly how it has been revealed, if you want to understand the Quran, then take the Quran from four people. And from amongst those four people, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned Salim, the freed slave of Abu Hudhayfa radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. The narrations mention that Umar bin Khattab radiyallahu anhu, when he was stabbed by Abu Lu'lu and when he was injured, he mentioned to the Sahaba, if it wasn't for the fact that Salim radiallahu anhu has passed away in the battle of Yamama, I would not take any consultation from anyone. I would make Salim, the freed slave of Abu Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu, the next Khalifa after me. This was the amount of respect that Umar radiallahu anhu had for Salim radiallahu anhu. Abu Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu, he also passed away in this battle and he became the beloved of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Many, many great other companions, Thabit bin Qais al-Shammas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he also became shaheed and he was also martyred. And you can understand how many great companions, they gave their life for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that this deen could be safeguarded and so that this fitna of Musaylimah Kadhab can be halted and it could come to an end. The light of the at the end of the tunnel was none other than the consultation of Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu that he gave to Abu Bakr Siddiq. After the battle of Yamama, he approached Abu Bakr Siddiq and he said, oh Abu Bakr, I advise you and I give you my opinion that you should collect the Quran. Why? Because many Huffaz have passed away in the battle of Yamama and I fear that the Quran will be taken away from the hearts of the people. It is best that you collect the Quran into a book form so that we can all go back to one book if their need arises. So on one side you have the sacrifice of the companions and on the other side we have the blessings that the companions left through their sacrifice.